the Diocese of Toledo, Ohio. The story of the faith in this region began with the labors of missionary priests, was sustained and nurtured by early immigrants to the region, and carries on today under the leadership of its current apostle, Bishop Daniel Edward Thomas.
So we know Pope Francis has that classic line, every priest should have the smell of the sheep. It's the bishop, his priests, the deacons, and lay faithful. It's all of us together who are the church.
This is the story of the bishops of America, the shepherds of the past and the shepherds of today, who through their callings and ministry carry the church into the future. It's also the story of their parish, their church, the cathedral. This is The Chair, an exploration of what it means to be an apostle in America. Occupying the northwest corner of the Buckeye State, the city of Toledo stands at the mouth of the largest watersheds anywhere in the Great Lakes. It is also the sea city of the Diocese of Toledo.
The history of Toledo is really part of a much greater history, the history of the Great Lakes and of the Rust Belt. Settled by various tribes of Native Americans, Northwest Ohio was first explored by Europeans when the French set up trading posts in the 1600s.
The area along Lake Erie was a path for missionaries, fur trappers, explorers, and traders in the 17th century who made their way down from Quebec and the upper Great Lakes region of the country. Settlers also come from Detroit and establish a fort on the Maumee River in the 1860s. The shores of Lake Erie also becomes a route for the Jesuits who in the mid-18th century come down from Detroit to start working with the Huron Native American community.
It wasn't until the 1820s and 30s that the region we now know as Toledo found its place on the map. The construction of the Miami and Erie Canal connected the western tip of Lake Erie to the Ohio River and beyond, opening trade routes all the way to New York via the Great Lakes and the Hudson River.
A more visible and permanent Catholic presence in the state of Ohio didn't emerge until the early 1800s, and it tended to concentrate along the southern tier of the state along the Ohio River. Among them was Father Edward Fenwick, the first bishop of Cincinnati. He was a Dominican priest who traveled up from Kentucky and became known as the Apostle of Ohio because of his extensive travels throughout the region. Early efforts to build up a Catholic presence in northwestern Ohio proved challenging. In 1845, a group of Ursuline nuns were sent to Toledo from Cleveland, and they experienced an arduous journey by horseback. And when they arrived in Toledo, they found the city a swampy and unhealthy place where fevers prevailed. And in fact, one of the early sisters soon fell ill and died.
So as these Catholic immigrant communities begin to settle in the area and join together at the mouth of what is the Maumee River, they name their city Toledo after the famous city in Spain, Toledo. And this area, this city Toledo, becomes a hub for manufacturing, glass manufacturing, automobiles, and eventually we see the rise of the railways, the train companies, and the population of Toledo begins to really grow during the 19th and 20th centuries, drawing greater Catholic immigrants into the area who really see this as an opportunity to set down roots and begin families and make their fortunes in this country.
Catholic sisters were also instrumental in helping lay the foundations for the Catholic Church's growth in northwestern Ohio, particularly in education and healthcare. In 1855, the Grey Nuns, a Canadian order, came to the city of Toledo in response to a cholera epidemic and established the city's first hospital, St. Vincent's.
Diocese of Toledo is created in 1910 by Pope Pius X from the territory that was taken from the Diocese of Cleveland, Ohio. Bishop Joseph Schrems of Grand Rapids, Michigan was named Toledo's first bishop.
During the early 20th century, when the Catholic Church was growing rapidly in the United States, it was common for mid-sized dioceses to serve as training ground for promising young bishops who seemed destined to move on to more prominent assignments. Joseph Schrems, the first bishop of Toledo, went on to become Bishop of Cleveland. His successor, Samuel Strich, went from Toledo to Milwaukee and then to Chicago, where he was named a cardinal. And Bishop Carl Alter was later appointed the Archbishop of Cincinnati.
One of the important spiritual centers in the Diocese of Toledo is the National Shrine of Our Lady of Consolation in Cary, Ohio. It's been dubbed the American Lourdes because of the large number of healings that have taken place there over the years.
The devotion at the shrine dates back to 1875, when the pastor of the parish brought a replica of Our Lady of Consolation back with him from Europe, where she had been venerated since the 1620s. Reports of miraculous healings brought a steady stream of pilgrims to the shrine, especially in the early 20th century, and the annual feast day in May became an immense celebration with processions and devotions.
The first cathedral of the Diocese of Toledo was the Cathedral of St. Francis de Sales. Built between 1862 and 1869, it's the oldest Catholic church still standing in Toledo. The second bishop of Toledo, Bishop Samuel Strich, broke ground on the new cathedral, Our Lady, Queen of the Most Holy Rosary, in 1925, despite the economic troubles of the Great Depression. The building was structurally complete in 1931, but not consecrated until 1940.
This incredible cathedral is one of the most exquisite in the United States of America. Rather than taking a building from Europe and dropping it into the American landscape, it really does seek to develop an American vocabulary, a local vocabulary. Nothing at all at Toledo is copied from another church. It really sought to create a language that is site-specific to the American church and very much succeeded in creating something unlike anything else, but absolutely legible and absolutely a part of our tradition. The decision to create this building with this incredible and very beautiful works of art with the finest artists of the period, right in the middle of the Great Depression, is a really important one. It reminds us that investing in the glorification of God and in the community are always good investments. And there is a great connection between beauty and dignity. The exterior has incredible detail that you would find in a medieval cathedral. So as you circumambulate the exterior, there are details that really could be overlooked, but they invite you in, and anyone tenacious enough to really look at them is rewarded with the history of the church, which unfolds in these little panels that are each sculpted with angels that sort of surround the exterior of the apse. And so it gives us that sense that we're crossing the threshold into the heavenly realm in this place where the heavenly liturgy takes place. We can see in the style of the murals threads related to the Boronese, certainly, style. This is a sort of flatness and ethereal quality. It really reminds us that the heavenly reality is not what we experience here. So, unlike naturalistic representations of people and of saints that try to capture a real terrestrial, earthly likeness, there's a purposeful abstraction to remind us that what we're looking at is ethereal. Geometric patterning on the ceiling of the barrel vault as one transitions into the sanctuary and the apse is reminiscent of cosmetic stonework inlay. So it gives everything this jewel tone. Everything is precious. And this collaboration to support the liturgy and the architecture with the artwork is a truly resplendent ecclesiastical expression of of art and architecture. The church is the greatest patron of the arts the world has ever known. And it's because it understands this ability of truly awe-inspiring work to draw us into the source of all beauty and all truth, which is God. In the sanctuary apse ceiling, just above the baldacchino, is a mural of Our Lady, Queen of the Most Holy Rosary, with God the Father, Christ, and the Holy Spirit above her, surrounded by heavenly beings, angels and seraphim, in a blue heavenly field. No element is purely decorative. Everything is related to unfolding the mysteries of faith for us. And so we have rainbows that relate back to God's covenant with Noah and reminding us that Christ is the new and everlasting covenant. There are a cloud of witnesses. So these are the saints, which we are all called to be. So this really unites the church militant, all of us, with the church triumphant.
One of the first things that's very striking when one walks in, of course, is that the whole cathedral, like a great cathedral of medieval times, is catechetical. So no matter where you find yourself in the cathedral, it's telling the story of our Catholic faith. One of the things I desire greatly to do is to be able to have the funding someday to put in the luminous mysteries of the Rosary, because the title of the cathedral is Our Lady, Queen of the Most Holy Rosary, to which we are greatly dedicated. And yet, of course, it was John Paul II who gave the luminous mysteries to the church. They're not yet depicted here in an iconographic way. So I very much want to do that, and I found the place to do it, because they're in the vaults of the side aisles of the cathedral are all the mysteries of the Rosary with an Old Testament prefigurement and then the New Testament event, which the Rosary mystery is based on.
The bishop's chair or cathedra inside the Cathedral of Our Lady, Queen of the Most Holy Rosary, symbolizes a bishop's role as the Apostle of Toledo.
I was born and raised in Philadelphia, so I'm a priest of the Archdiocese of Philadelphia. I grew up in a little town called Manayunk, which is a Native American word which means place to go to draw water. My mom and dad were very simple people, neither of whom had a high school diploma. My mother, in fact, and my dad said that they had to go to work to help their families during the Great Depression. My mother was a stay-at-home mom, so she was a homemaker, at least until we got into school, so that she would be present with us in the home. And then I think together with my dad, they taught me the extraordinary gift of the Catholic faith. They taught me how to love and to be loved. And they taught me how deeply the faith had influenced them. And fundamentally, they also taught me everything about what married love is because of their fidelity to one another. At my mother's death, they were 51 years married. And they taught me everything about what I needed to live my Catholic faith. The first inkling I had to the possibility of a vocation to the priesthood was at 7 years old. And I always say my vocation story is a very boring one because there is no great conversion, there is no extraordinary story. It was simply the I think, slow but deliberate intentionality of the Lord drawing me, in particular, through example. So I tell people that the first example for my vocation came from my own parents and their fidelity to their vocation in the church and their openness that we would receive any vocation from the Lord, whatever that vocation might be. It came from the priests of my parish, my home parish, and my high school, who were very much models and mentors and examples to me. And even at 7 years old and then later, I really saw the possibility in them that perhaps I too could do this for Christ and His church. So my parents and my brother had very different reactions because I chose not to tell my family intentionally until I would be accepted, because I thought, if I'm not accepted, there's no point in telling them that I want to enter the seminary. So by God's grace, I applied and was accepted. And one evening at dinner, I was telling my family, because we were all gathered together, And immediately my parents expressed their support. My brother threw his spoon into the soup, pushed away from the table, left the table and said, "This is a complete waste. I can't believe you're going to throw away your life." And so that was rather striking for me because it was my only brother saying these things. But little by little, I think he came around. And after I entered the seminary, he came to visit with my parents. And when he visited, he put his hand on my shoulder and he looked at me and he said, "You're happy, aren't you?" And I said, "Yes, I'm quite happy." And he said, "Is this what you want to do?" And I said, "I believe that for now, this is what Jesus desires of me, to follow the vocation and to test it and discern whether or not it is God's will that I be a priest for his church." And my brother said, "If you're happy, then I'm happy." And the day of my ordination for priesthood, afterwards, there's a tradition that the newly ordained offer first blessings for their families in the cathedral. And when I gave the first blessing to my brother, he physically lifted me. He was 6'2", so he's much bigger than me. He lifted me off my feet and spun me around, and I've never felt such joy in my entire life.
After ordination, Father Thomas served as a parochial vicar before being sent to Rome for graduate studies in dogmatic theology. He was an official of the Congregation for Bishops in the Roman Curia from 1990 to 2005, while also serving as spiritual director to the seminarians of the North American College.
I had the profound gift of working 15 years under Pope John Paul as the pontiff. And in the congregation, I would say there must have been at least 15 countries represented in the officials who served there. So there were priests, lay men and women, consecrated religious, and then in every congregation, there's a prefect, a secretary, and an undersecretary. I had to learn a tremendous amount about how the office itself operates, as any person who goes into a new employment or new work would do. And I grew, perhaps the first and most foremost impact was growing in a deep appreciation for the universality of the church. So to work in an office where there were other workers on my level from Europe, from South America, from North America, from Africa, it was a tremendous gift to realize the church universal. And you were working, of course, directly across the street from where the Holy Father, the shepherd of the universal church, lived and worked.
In 2006, Father Thomas was named an auxiliary bishop for the Archdiocese of Philadelphia.
I get the question, well, can a priest say no? And the answer to that is, well, yes. In fact, when I was named a bishop, I was told by the Cardinal Archbishop that I would be an auxiliary bishop. I was appointed by Pope Benedict XVI, and I asked, may I say no? And the Cardinal Archbishop at that time looked at me square in the eyes, and he said, without skipping a beat, do you think that's the response Jesus wants to hear? Well, confronted with that, I said, I guess not. So knowing my own sinfulness and weakness, but depending upon God's grace, and that it's the will of the Pope and the Holy Spirit, then I say yes. So when I was named a bishop, first, of course, you receive the word personally, but then you receive a letter from the Apostolic Nuncio, the Pope's representative, and that letter is the official appointment. So I prayed about and asked my spiritual director, how would I tell my family? And of course, you get permission, you're given permission to tell your father. So I went through his mail that evening, that Sunday night, and then I handed him the letter from the nuncio. And I said, Dad, I have some mail I think you might be interested in. Why don't you read this? So he read my appointment right in front of me, and he began to weep. And then he said, well, let me be, you know, the first to congratulate you on being a bishop. And then he said, get out the glasses, because let me be the first to toast you as a bishop. And of course, he wept with great joy, and he was present by God's grace at my actual ordination as a bishop.
After 8 years as auxiliary bishop in Philadelphia, Bishop Thomas was named the next bishop of Toledo, Ohio in 2014.
When I first was named bishop, of course, as every bishop, you're not announced yet. So you arrive under cover of darkness before the press conference the next day. So that evening here in the rectory, I was able to have supper with the diocesan administrator and the priests who lived in the rectory. And before I even walked in, I looked, you know, at this house and I thought, my word. And I thought, my goodness, Lord, I am not worthy. Look at this home. My first thing my mother would say is, you know, who do you think you are to live in a house like this? And then they brought me over to the cathedral. And then I said, Lord, now I know I am not worthy.
In the years since becoming bishop, Bishop Thomas has worked to shepherd his people with the heart of an apostle. He is particularly passionate about caring for his fellow laborers in the vineyard, his priests.
We have wonderful priests who are selfless, who are dedicated, who are committed, and we have priests who are from the whole diocese, which means that we have a very vast diversity of demographics. So, for example, 65% of our diocese is rural, and many of our priests come from rural, smaller communities. We also find that priests have a deep attachment, and a beautiful one, to their families. One of the great gifts we have here, especially among our younger priests and older priests, is a camaraderie and fraternity, which I know does not necessarily exist in every place. And I can say in 5.5 years that I've been bishop in the Diocese of Toledo, whenever I've had a need and I've asked a priest to assist me in my need, across the board, there has never been a no. There's always been, yes, Bishop, I'm ready and willing to serve, however you need me to help you. What an extraordinary gift for any bishop to have a priest be so generous as to say, I'll step in wherever you need me to step in. But I think for the bishop, and I strive to be father, brother, and friend. So it's really, I think, in the simple ways of assistance that you are first and foremost present to them, that you love them, whether they receive that love or not, that you are charitable and forgiving and merciful and encouraging and supportive. So it's making the effort to encourage their priestliness and at the same time be one with them as a brother priest.